sing a couple songs. I'm just glad to be here. Apparently you're not supposed to drive with that gas light blinking for 3 days. That's not a good idea. Learn from my mistakes. My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm, my help is on the way, my help is on the way. We're singing, oh my God, He will not delay. Trouble surrounds me, chaos abounding, my soul will rest in you. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm, my help is on the way, my help is on the way. We're singing, oh my God, He will not delay, my refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true, my God will come through always, always. Thank you.
It's close, yeah. Yeah, it's close to glory to God. You're actually singing some Hebrew there. Okay, so the Hebrew word halal means to praise. And Yah is short for Yahweh, which is the Lord. So when you're saying halal, praise, Yahweh, the Lord, you're singing praise the Lord. So when we sing hallelujah, we're singing praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Our God reigns, and He surely does that. I'm glad you're here. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do praise You. Hallelujah. We praise You, our Lord. We thank You so much for who You are. We thank You that You are victorious and mighty. We thank You, You are glorious. And Lord, You are worthy to be worshipped. It's so good to be able to worship here in this place this morning. We want to give You all glory and praise, Lord. As we're here at the last chapel, we just are excited. We want to thank You for what You have done in the lives of all of us who've been a part this year. Father, we just thank You for working in our minds and our hearts this year, growing us, calling us to Yourself. And Lord, I just pray that You would continue to have Your perfect will and way in us. Lord, I just pray for Brian as he comes up and speaks. And God, just anoint him and give him the words that you would have him say to us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, glad you're here. Go ahead and have a seat. Just a quick introduction for our speaker today. His name is Brian Davis, and he is the worship pastor and young adults pastor at Temple Baptist Church here in Hobbs, and he's been there for about 9 years. We don't really edify him much because Dane calls him all kinds of names. They've known each other for forever, and I told him, man, this is the last chapel of the semester, so don't stink, because this is what everybody's going to remember for the rest of the summer. So no pressure, buddy. Come on up. Would y'all join me in welcoming Brian Davis?
Well, good morning, and I appreciate you asking me to come and speak. We're going to be in John chapter 15 today, so if you have your Bibles, and I hope you do, if you'll join me there. Has anyone ever asked the question, what am I doing here? What am I doing dropping the mic already? I'm not even done. There we go. All right. What am I doing here? What am I doing here in chapel, listening to some short, chubby, balding guy talk to me? What am I doing at USW? What am I doing in Hobbs, New Mexico, of all places? This thing has me worried now. One second. What am I doing here on Earth? Anybody thought that? Okay, I have to. I think it's a pretty common question, really. I think most people ask that question at some point in their life. They want to know that their life, what they're doing, the choices that they're making, that it's going to have a lasting impact, that it's going to leave some kind of legacy, that it's going to affect their lives, their family lives, their family's lives, or whatever, in some significant way. They want to know that they're not wasting their time, they're not wasting their life. So I think that's a valid question. And I think it's one that Jesus addresses here in John 15, just to give you some context of where we're at. Jesus is the day before his crucifixion here with his disciples. And he knows that they're about to be at a point in their life where they go, what am I doing here? Jesus has, he's died, he's ascended, they know that this is coming. And I'm stuck here holding the pieces, you know, like, what am I doing here? And so Jesus is gonna give them an answer that is gonna help them through that question, and I hope it does for you as well. So if you have your Bibles, John 15, let's start in verse 8. We're going to start at the end so that we can better understand the beginning. It's kind of like if you've seen the movie Sixth Sense, if you've seen the end, it helps you understand what was going on in the rest of the movie. So, what am I doing here? By this, my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. So we have to understand that our created purpose here on earth is twofold. One, it is to have a relationship with Christ, and two, it is to bring the Father glory through our lives. So how do we do that? It says in verse 9, as the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. That's the relationship part. It's a connectedness. The word abide means to live in or to remain in, to be connected to. But then he says, by this, in verse 8, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. So we have to ask, what does it mean to glorify God? And two, what does it mean to bear fruit? Well, they're interconnected. They mean the the same thing. To bear fruit is to glorify God, but what is bearing fruit? Bearing fruit is reflecting God's character in our lives. It's reflecting God's character to a lost world. Fruit is the reproductive means of a plant, right? And so God works through our lives and then allows us to work in other people's lives through his power, right? That's bearing fruit. We have to understand, too, that in Genesis, we are created in God's image. And so it is our responsibility, is it our created purpose to bring him glory. And we do that by reflecting his character. So I was an art major in college. We did sculpting, painting, drawing, all that kind of stuff. And I realized that wouldn't pay the bills, so I went into ministry. But anyways, we have people sculpt, right? And if you had a sculpture or a painting or whatever, people would come up and admire the painting, admire the sculpture, admire the art. But it wasn't really the artwork that was getting the glory, was it? No, it's the artist, right? When we look at a Picasso painting, Picasso gets the praise, right? Well, we're created in God's image. It's like if I had a statue of Dane up here, right? He was holding his guitar, he was in like a power stance, you know, whatever. You wouldn't walk by and go, oh, that statue plays such beautiful music. Has such a lovely tone in its voice. Can really jam out. I don't know, whatever you would say. You wouldn't say that to the statue. You would look at the statue and go, Dane has all those things, but I'm lying. He doesn't. I'm just kidding. We're good friends. We're old friends. The same way with us. It's not about people looking at us and going, oh, how great they are. Matthew tells us, so let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. When they look at us, when they see Christ in us, it's God who gets the glory. So that's our other creative purpose. To bear fruit means to reflect the character of God, bringing him glory. Now let's go back and look at verses 1 through 7. It says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into a fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. Let's read verses 8 and 9 again. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. Now, Jesus is using a picture here to describe that relationship and that process of bringing him glory to that of grapevines, right? And we don't really have vineyards around here. But hopefully you can get the picture. You know what a grapevine is? Everybody knows what a grapevine is because the raisins told you. The grapevines are vines, and they grow up and they bear grapes. That's what they do. And so Jesus is saying, I am the true vine and you are the branches. Who are the branches? All of you, right? Everyone. Everyone is a branch. Now, as a branch, we can either be connected to Christ, to the vine, or we cannot be. So first, let's look at the branches that are connected. First, he says, every branch in me, every branch that's connected to me, that does not bear fruit, he takes away. Now, I've heard a lot of people speak on this, these verses, and it almost sounds like he's removing them from him. But I don't believe that's true at all. If you look at the original language, the word takes away there means to lift up, right? So a vine planted along the ground would grow. Watermelons grow on vines along the ground, right? Grapevines, however, do not bear fruit if they are growing on the ground. They have to be lifted up. And so every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he lifts up, right? To allow it to bear fruit. He repositions it. He removes, is what some versions say. And so Position is an important aspect of this relationship. God has placed us in a place where we can bear fruit. If we are not bearing fruit, he will reposition us in a place that we can bear fruit. That's one of the things he does. So position is important. Also in that same verse, pruning is important. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes that it may bear more fruit. Pruning is not a fun process, especially if you are the branch, right? Pruning is cutting, cutting away of dead stuff or disease stuff so that you can bear more fruit. We have rose bushes at my house, and if the rose bushes bloom and we do not prune off the dead buds, they won't flower again, or very few flowers will come up. But if you prune those off, more flowers will come up. It's the same with grapes. If you prune the areas, you get more fruit. And so pruning is a thing that God does in our life. If we're bearing fruit for him, if we're abiding in him, we're living in him, we're remaining in him, and we're bearing fruit, he is going to prune things out of our life in order that we bear more fruit. This is not a fun process, but he does it anyway, right? He's going to take negative things out or evil things out, sin out of our lives. He's going to prune that out of our lives. And sometimes that hurts really badly. But that's what he wants us to do so that we can bear fruit. He wants to prune that out of our life. He's also going to prune out neutral things, hobbies and things that get in our way, get in the way of our relationship with him. And sometimes he'll even prune out good things so that we can bear more fruit. So position, pruning. Verse 3, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Again, we're talking to the branches that are connected to Christ. Verse 4, abide in me and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. So part of this whole relationship, part of what Jesus is trying to relay to his disciples is not only that I've put you in a position to bear fruit, not only am I sanctifying your life and cutting things out of your life that are keeping you from bearing more fruit, I'm also empowering you with my power to bear fruit. Abide in me and I in you. So apart from me, you can do nothing. Right? So we question, why am I here? What is the purpose of this life? Why am I making these choices? And if Christ is not at the center of those, they're not making a positive impact. They're not being something that is going to bear fruit, something that is going to reflect the character of Christ to others. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into a fire, and burned. In my backyard, we have honeysuckle that has died. It's grown up all over the fence. It's huge. I'm not good at yard work. But now is the time that I have to get rid of that because it's just taking over. So the other day, I was outside, and I was pulling off honeysuckle. And it's dried up, it's old, it's dead. And I was studying for this, and I thought, I want to test this theory. So I bundled up a big section of honeysuckle that had dried out, and I put it in my fireplace, and it lit instantly. And it burned fast and hot, and for not very long, it just was like that, and it was all burnt up. And that's the kind of life impact we have when we're not connected to Christ. We can burn fast and hot for a short time, but there's really no lasting impact. There's really no fruit that continues to make fruit, right? There's nothing that continues. It's just gone like that. I do believe this is talking about eternity as well, but I think we can apply it to our daily lives too, in that when we're not connected to Christ, our life really has no impact. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is not a name it, claim it verse. This is Jesus telling us that when we're living in him, he will change our desires. And he desires nothing more than to fulfill his own will. And that's not a bad thing, because if you were the creator of the universe, you could fulfill your own will, and no one could say anything about it, right? But you're not, and he is. And he deserves that glory, and he deserves that honor. And so he will change our desires to ask what is his desires, and then he will gladly grant those, right? Sometimes it seems like we're beating our head against the wall, trying to get things accomplished in our life, but we're asking in our own desires, not caring at all about his will, not caring at all about his desires. But we know when we abide in him, he changes ours. We ask what he desires, and then he gladly gives that to us. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. So I hope today that you can leave and know that wherever you are, wherever the summer takes you, wherever next semester takes you, wherever the next job takes you, wherever you end up, that God has positioned you there for a purpose to bear fruit. That he's going to prune things out of your life that are keeping you from bearing fruit, and he's going to empower you to bear fruit in his name. Let's pray. Dear Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for the opportunity to look into your word today. We thank you for the truth of your word, and we thank you for Jesus and for the sacrifice he made on the cross for us, Lord. We thank you for his power that we can live a life that bears fruit, a life that reflects you the way that you have called us to reflect you. We thank you for all that you've done for us, and we pray for these students. We pray that they have a good summer, and these teachers as well. We pray that they would be focused on you. In Jesus' name.
Them out Tuesday night, a week from yesterday, in the library at 8 o'clock, is going to be a pancake festivity. I don't know, pancake meal, so that you guys can eat, celebrate, and study. Okay, so I have some of these right here. Then I also have some prayer cards here that, if you don't mind, just come up, student, anybody, come up and sign these prayer cards. There was a tragedy, was it this weekend or last weekend, at a couple of fellow Christian colleges, East Texas Baptist University and Dallas Baptist University. They had some students pass away in a car accident. So we'd like to reach out to them by sending them these prayer cards. Please, if you don't mind, just come down and write a note, sign it, and say a prayer for them. Also, I have the usual sign-in sheets for those of you who have class. So make sure and come and sign in for class. Andy, you got anything else?
Yes. The last activity for this year will be volleyball intramurals tomorrow at 6 o'clock, I believe, in the new gym. So come by. If you're not a team, it's all right. Show up and we'll put you on a team, no problem. So
awesome.
Have a safe summer.
Haley,
yes. Yes.
Okay, so Dane, come here, bud. I think that, is this right? Like, this is your last chapel, right? Okay. So he will be here for baccalaureate. By the way, baccalaureate is going to be on the same day as graduation rehearsal. If you are still here in town, we would love to have you join us for baccalaureate. It is our time where we gather together as, to really just send off our graduating students with a good Christian challenge. And so he'll be here for that. But this is Dane's last chapel for us. And so if y'all would, go over and give him a big hug and kiss and whisper sweet nothings into his ear. But just if we could, can we just thank Dane for his work this year. That's all I had.
Awesome. And starting Saturday night at 9 o'clock, the library is closed, but from 9 to midnight, starting Saturday this weekend through exam week, I'll be in there with coffee for free. If you'd like coffee or lattes, and you can come study. I think that's everything. If I forgot something,